Hare Krishna. So today will be the concluding session on the demons and Krishna Lila, which we've been discussing for the last, since Tuesday, with a couple of days of break in between. So we talked about Putana, then Shaktasur and Trinavat. Now I'll talk about the demon named Vatsasur. Krishna, as he grew up, one after another, there were many dangers that were coming. And the Vrajavasis became alarmed. So they decided to move from Gokul, where all these dangerous demons were coming, to Vrindavan. They thought, at this place, maybe there is something inauspicious. So if too many bad things are happening, better move away from here. So if we have children and if we are staying in a particular locality and there are too many unpleasant, dangerous incidents, there is accident, there is stealing, there is thuggery, then the parents may feel this is not a safe locality to live in. Let's move to some other locality. So similarly, the Vrajavasis felt that maybe this is not a safe locality. So they had a discussion and eventually they decided that let's move to another place. This is Vrindavan, is a beautiful place, and if we go there will be auspiciousness. And thinking like this, they packed all their belongings onto huge carts and they started moving. And then when they settled in Vrindavan, by this time Krishna had also started growing. And although Krishna before this had come out of Vrindavan come out of Gokul and moved around here and there, but he had never gone deep into the forest because it's just a small child. But this time when they had their carts going through, Krishna and Balaram were sitting on the laps of Yashoda and Rohini, and they were asking, what is this bird, what is this tree, what is this flower? And for the children, it is a nature, is an endless source of curiosity. So they're so excited. And then when they got there, finally, when they came to Vrindavan, they were happy. But then Krishna started thinking, the forest was such fun. And he just passed by once. If you could explore there, it would be so nice. And I started thinking, how will I get my parents to allow me to go out and explore? And then he got an idea. He said, Nanda Baba, we are all cowherds. You are a cowherd and I also have to become a cowherd in future. So please, now it is time for me. Please give me my own cows to take care of. And Nanda Baba was surprised. Normally, if children have to be given some responsibility, parents sometimes have to push the children. You know, tell them to study, tell them to do some course at home, tell them to do some things which need to be done. Children normally don't come up to themselves to do it. For Nanda Maharaj's surprise, he started thinking about it. And then naturally, he discussed with Yashodamai. And Yashodamai said, what are you talking about? He is still a child. He is still drinking my breast milk. How can he alone go into the forest? Now while Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda were sitting and discussing, Krishna knew it was the fate of his dream was based on this discussion. So when they were discussing inside a room, Krishna was at the door, window, at the door, hearing with his ears. And then when Yashoda Mai said no, Krishna immediately burst in. Yashoda Mai, you don't allow me to have any fun. He said, I'm not going to listen to you. Whatever you think, whatever you say, I'm going to go to the forest. Nanda Baba, I want to go. And then, Shudama was so surprised and so shocked to see this defiance of Krishna. And Krishna is very intelligent. Small boy, in fact, small boys, when they want to, small children, when they want to get something done, they know exactly how to do it. So immediately, now what happened over here was, Yashodama was saying, no, Krishna should not go. And Krishna was saying, I want to go. And Nanda Maharaj is caught in between. And then the Maharaj didn't know what to do. As he was thinking about it, suddenly Krishna changed tack. And Krishna said, "Oh, Ishtamai, all my cowherd boys, boyfriends would be with me. I'll be safe. You don't have to worry. And I will not go very far into the forest. Don't worry, I'll be safe." And Krishna made such a pitiable, sweet face that Yashoda Mai just could not refuse. She just didn't have the heart to refuse at that time. And Nanda Maharaj looked at Krishna, she looked at Yashoda Mai, and he said, "Nanda Baba, I want to go to the forest." When he spoke like this, he looked, Nanda Baba looked at Yashoda Mai, and to his surprise, Yashoda Mai remained silent. And Krishna started jumping in joy. "Yes, I will go to the forest. I'll go to the forest. I'll go with the cows." Now, at that time, Nanda Baba didn't tell. Krishna was thinking, "I will go with the cows." But Nanda Baba decided that, let him not go with the cows first. Let him go with the calves. He'll have small calves. So then they arranged for, there was a festival, Gopashtami. There's a time when Krishna is entrusted the care of the cows. Now, Yashoda Mai was still worried. "My little baby, if he goes to the forest, what will happen to him? There are so many dangers in the forest. There are thorns, there are pebbles, there are brambles." And she said, "Krishna, I will give you some shoes. You can wear this footwear so that your feet will be protected." Krishna looked at the footwear and he said, "Yashoda Mai," he said, "Maya, we are all gopas, isn't it?" He said, "Yes." "That means we are meant to take care of the cows and we are meant to serve the cows." "Yes." Yashoda Mai knew this question was going somewhere which was unpleasant. That is something which she would not want, this question was going there. She didn't know what was happening. He says, "That means actually we are the servants of the cows and the cows are our masters." He said, "Yes." "Then if I am going to wear shoes, then all my cows should also have shoes." And Krishna said, "You're counting." Now Nanda Baba had thousands and thousands, so many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of cows. Thousands. Krishna started thinking, "I don't have so many shoes." He said, "Krishna, we don't have so many shoes. But you should wear shoes." He said, "No. If the cows are not going to wear shoes, then I am also not going to wear shoes." And then Yashoda Mai became very anxious. What will happen to Krishna if he doesn't wear any shoes? Now while this conversation was going on, this is just going on in the courtyard of the house. And nearby were the sheds. And in those sheds, the cows were hearing. The cows, they all loved Krishna just like Yashoda Mai loved Krishna. The cows were also like a mother for Krishna. Gomata, the cow is considered to be a mother. And they were also as concerned for Krishna as Yashoda Mai was. And they started thinking, "Yes, Yashoda Mai is right." They're thinking, our feet, we have hooves. The hooves are tough and they don't get hurt, but Krishna's feet are tender and they will get hurt. And they started thinking that if Krishna can give up his shoes for us, if he wants to serve us, we also want to serve him. So they started thinking what to do. And their desire to serve Krishna was so strong that night, the ropes which were tying the cows to the sheds suddenly opened. And all the cows came out of their sheds and they ran out to the forest of Vrindavan. And they ran to the forest of Vrindavan. There, all on the paths where Krishna would walk, the cows went over there and started stamping their heavy hooves over there. And by stamping their hooves, they broke to powder all the pebbles, all the thorns, all the sharp branches. And they made the whole dust of Vrindavan soft and gentle. you know, as soft as if it were like a Johnson & Johnson baby powder. So, the cows, Krishna's love for the cows was such that he did not want anything that the cows did not have. But the cows did not want Krishna to suffer. The cows made all of Vrindavan very, very filled with soft dust. And all night they were going across Vrindavan, finding every place where there might be anything sharp and crushing it to powder. And then they came back. Such was the concern of everyone in Vrindavan for Krishna. And actually, similar was the concern of Krishna for everyone in Vrindavan. The next morning, when Krishna had to go, Krishna called his friends. He had a horn, he blew the horn, and all his friends came running. And when they all came running, then Krishna was so happy, and they all started going out. When they started going out, at that time, Nanda Baba and Yashoda Bai, they were so concerned, they started following Krishna. And Krishna went to the forest, and they kept following. And they went inside, and Krishna and Nanda Baba and Yashoda Bai kept going. Now, some of the cowherd boys were older than Krishna. So they had already started going to the forest. So they were going, and none of their parents were there. So now, if a child is with a group of other children and only his parents are there, the child feels embarrassed. And Krishna was looking back at his parents. He said, Maya, Baba, I know how to herd cows. You can go back home. He said, I'll take care of things. He says, no. He says, we'll come with you just for today. So Krishna said, just for today you go back. Tomorrow you come. And Krishna told them, this is my first day. And Krishna was embarrassed. All the gopas were looking at him and they were having fun at his expense. And he was looking at them, he was looking at his mother. And his mother's parents also understood. He says, Krishna, don't go very far. If I told you go by this door, road, go only by this road. Don't go anywhere else. And they saw Krishna off. As Krishna was going into the forest, all the Vrajvasis were looking at him. The Jandamai and Nandamai and Yashodamai came out of their houses, came out of the forest path. But everyone was coming out. From wherever they could, they were looking at Krishna, trying to catch sight of Krishna as far as their eyes would see. Chalasiyad Vrajaj Charayan Pashun Nalina Sundaram Nathate Padam Shila Trunankurai Sidati Tina Kalila Tamana Kanta Gachati. So the later the gopis, in their Gopi Gita, they say, Krishna, when you go into the forest to graze the cows, Chalasiyat Vrajaj, you go into the forest, Vrajaj, Charayan Pashun, to graze the cows. At that time, the only thought that comes in our mind throughout the day is, Nalina Sundaram Nathate Padam, that your feet are as soft as a lotus flower. What will happen to that lotus feet, those lotus feet, when they are pierced by the thorns of Vrindavan? Now the cows had done this protection, but the gopas and gopis didn't know that Krishna was protected like this. They are thinking still the forest of Vrindavan, it's filled with dangers. So because of that, they were still in so much anxiety. And they said, Krishna, just the thought that one thorn will pierce your foot. Now that thought pierces our heart. In fact, it rips our heart apart, Krishna. Please come back. And then when Krishna would go to the forest, he would go and the Vrajvasis' hearts would go with him. Atatiyat Bhavan
ahani kananam triti yugayate twama pashyatam.
The gopis say that, Krishna, when you go to the forest at that time, one moment appears to be like a whole yuga for us. It appears to be as if its time is never ending. Suppose we have been fasting all day and say Janmashtami night is there and we are feeling tormented by thirst and hunger. And then it's 9 o'clock and then we are 3 hours now I have to wait. I have waited for 21 hours, now 3 more hours I have to wait. And then we are feeling tormented by water, tormented by food, tormented by hunger and thirst. And I look at the clock. From 9 it has only become 9:01. And we do something, everything, now 10 minutes have passed, we look at the clock, it's only 9:02. And then we do something and again look at the clock, it's only 9:03. What is happening? We feel as if time is going very slowly. Because when in the future, there is something which we very strongly long for. Then we are living for that future. And the journey from the present to the future simply seems to be like an interference that we want to get over with. It's like, suppose there is an exciting movie going on and the hero and the villain, they are fighting and the fighting has come to a climax. The villain has knocked the hero down from mountain cliff and the hero is just somehow holding on. And the villain is about to stamp his feet on the hands of the hero. And right at that time, a commercial break comes. We'll feel so angry. When will this commercial break end? One moment we feel it's unbearable. So like that, for the gopis, it was unbearable. So everybody in Vrindavan was worried about Krishna. How is Krishna? When is Krishna going to come back? In fact, the gopis pray that they are at home and they are looking at the sky. And they see, oh, the sun is so fortunate. And the sun is able to behold Krishna. But we are not able to behold Krishna. And then as they are looking at the sky, sometimes the sun is there and sometimes the sun gets covered by clouds. And then the gopis start thinking, when the sun is covered by the clouds, oh, actually, maybe the sun becomes very hot. As the sun was looking at Krishna, Krishna must have started sweating. And that's why this cloud wanted to give some shade to Krishna. And that's why the cloud has come and says, the cloud is now serving Krishna. But alas, we are so far away, we can't serve Krishna. And then a slight drizzle starts coming. And then the drizzle starts coming, at that time, the gopis think, oh, actually, because of the sun, Krishna must have felt very hot. That's why this cloud is serving Krishna by drizzling some water over here. And then, as the sun is concealed behind the cloud, then because the sun is falling on the clouds dry up. And the clouds dry up, at that time, the clouds move aside and the sun comes back again. And then the Rajvasis think, oh, the sun is now again serving Krishna. Maybe the rains were too much. And now the cloud, they're gone, and now the sun is drying Krishna. So they're thinking, nature, the sun, the clouds, they all have an opportunity to see Krishna. They all have an opportunity to serve Krishna. We are so unfortunate, we don't have an opportunity to serve Krishna. Every night, when Krishna would come back, all of Vrindavan would come out to see Krishna. And they would all be waiting. When is Krishna going to come? When is Krishna going to come? And then when Krishna would come, the first sign that Krishna is coming would be that a huge dust cloud would come over there. A dust cloud, because all the calves would be ahead. And those calves, as they would be walking, the calves' hooves, when they would fall on the ground, that would cause dust to rise. So, normally, if we are driving and if a mist comes in the way, or if we are looking for something and a mist comes in the way, a dust cloud comes in the way, we would be annoyed. But the Vrajvasis would become delighted when the dust cloud would come. Although they would not see anything, now they knew. This not seeing anything is the sign that now we are going to see something wonderful. Now we are going to see our Lord. That just the sight of the dust cloud
would fill them with joy.
And then, as the cows would come forward, the dust cloud would go down. As the dust cloud would go down, they would start seeing the cows. And they were looking for Krishna. Now at this age, Krishna was not very tall. So, if the cows are this height, Krishna was a little more than the cows. So, they would try to catch sight of Krishna. Where is Krishna? Where is Krishna? What Krishna would do is, he would be right at the back of all the cows. Because Krishna is a caring cowherd, would make sure that not a single calf would get lost. So he would be behind all of them watching. Oh, is this calf running away? Is this calf running in this direction? Is this calf running in this direction? And if the calf would run away, Krishna knew the names of every one of the calves. And he would call them with such love, wherever they were to run away, they would come back just to hear Krishna call them. And then Krishna would return behind all of them. So such was the way in which Krishna's boyhood pastimes continued. Where Krishna was reciprocating love with the cows and his cowherd boyfriends in the daytime and in the morning. And in the evening, he would be reciprocating love with his parents. And in this idyllic setting, where wonderful things were going on, suddenly something terrible happened. The world is such a place that danger can come upon us in the least unexpected way. The least unexpected way. We may think that some activities are so safe. Normally we come back home after we are tired and we sit down at a dining table. Now is the time when I want to have food. So we want to relax and eat food. But there are so many people who, while eating food, sometimes get a problem. One time I was traveling from one place to another and I was at the airport. I was just taking some prasad and in the food, there were dates and those dates had their seeds removed. So I was eating those dates with the seeds removed. And among those dates, somehow there was one seed which was just left as it is. And I just took that and ate it and the seed came right in the way. I chewed it and right I could hear a cracking sound. It was not the date seed breaking, it was my tooth breaking. And instead of the seed coming out of the mouth, the tooth came out filled with blood. So, normally we would think eating is such a safe activity. We don't think of eating as a dangerous activity. The Bhagavatam says there is danger at every step. But actually, even without taking any step also there can be danger. Sitting at one place also there can be danger. So, anyway, normally cows themselves are considered to be such a gentle, sweet creatures. And baby cows are so much sweeter, so much, so attractive they are. And one of Kamsa's demons came in that garb. He arranged in such a way that he took on the form of a Vatsa. Vatsa is a gentle small calf. And when he came in that form, he sneaked in and normally every day the cows go out. So Vatsa, what he did was that he appeared to be just like one of the cows. His demons, they can not only take on any form, but they can take on any form and they can impersonate that form in such a way that they appear authentically like that only. Of course, they appear authentic to those who do not have the sharp vision to see. So then, just like if we have two twins, from a distance the two twins look exactly similar. But when we get to know each of them, then we understand that they have their personality, they have their individuality. And then after knowing them for some time, you may think, how could I have thought the two of them are identical? They are so different. So similarly, from a distance, two cows may appear to be very similar.
But for one who has a personal relationship with the cows, they can make out each calf that is there. And as these calves, this Vatsasura just joined the ranks of the calves. Vatsasura did not know what a loving bond was there between him and Krishna. Between the Krishna and the calves. And when he just sneaked in, he thought, I'm just looking like another calf. And he had made his form so that he looked very similar to all the other calves. And he thought, I'm safe. But Krishna was looking at all the cows, and as he was looking at the cows, at that time immediately he noticed, hey, who's this? Who's this? So, although he had put on his mask, he had put on his appearance, but he could not deceive Krishna. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Dyutam Chalayatam Asvi. He says, among deceivers, I am the greatest deceiver. In every field of expertise, Krishna is the most expert. So, Vatsasura came to deceive Krishna. And we will see that each of these demons, they take some such forms. If Putana took the form of a nurse, Vatsasura took the form of a calf. And while everyone else was deluded, but Krishna was not deluded. It's interesting that in this case, Vatsasura took such a form that even the other cows were deluded. When in the Ramayana, Maricha took a form. What form did Maricha take? A deer. Mruga. When Maricha took the form of a deer, at that time, he was just prancing around the hermitage of Ram and Sita, and Sita's attention was attracted. Now what he did, he wanted to attract Sita, so he sort of overdid his costume. Sometimes some people want to look attractive, and what happens is they may put on so much makeup, so much costume, that they look artificial because of that. So what happened with, he wanted to attract Sita, so he overdid his costume. And he overdid his costume so much that he looked such an attractive deer, the Sita was attracted. He said, Ram, can you get that for me? And then Lakshman said, I don't think this deer belongs to the 8.4 million species. He said, just look, a deer is a harmless creature, but look at all the other animals, the squirrels, the birds, they're all keeping a long distance. He says, this is not a deer. In fact, Lakshman at that time, yes, I think this is a demon who is impersonating as a deer. And Sita was so attractive. He says, Lakshman, why are you so suspicious? Such an attractive deer. So Ram, get this deer for me. The point I am making here is, Maricha, when he did impersonated as a deer, at that time, the other animals were not taken. They were not deceived. But Vatsasura, he impersonated as a Vatsa, took on the form of a calf so well that none of the other calves were keeping a distance from him. But the other calves also thought he was one of them. But what happened? Krishna noticed. And Krishna looked at Balram. Said, Balram, Dauji, is this one of our calves? Or is this someone impersonating as a cow? And Balram looked at him. Balram looked carefully and nodded. And this calf was just moving around, looking here and there. And the calf was actually there waiting for an opportunity to attack Krishna. But Krishna was waiting for an opportunity to catch the calf. So then, as there were so many cows moving here, moving there, Krishna quietly came behind the calf. And before the demon could understand what had happened, suddenly he found himself lifted off the ground and high up in the sky. Hey, what happened? He said, looking here and there. And Krishna just picked up the calf by the left hand and started whirling him in the air. Whirling him, whirling him, whirling him.
And as he was whirling him, Krishna whirled him so fast and so forcefully that the demon lost consciousness, lost his life there itself. And then after whirling him at a heavy speed, Krishna hurled him into the trees, but crashed into the tree and fell down. And as he was crashing into the tree and falling down, suddenly his form changed from that of this tender looking calf to a giant grotesque looking demon. And as the demon fell down dead, the devatas who were observing in the sky were astounded at such a fierce demon, and Krishna so effortlessly just finished it. And they all started showering flowers on Krishna. Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki jai. So such was the effortless way in which Krishna destroyed all the demons. Bala kridanakam iva. As if a child playing with toys. One characteristic of Krishna's pastimes in Vrindavan is that Krishna never picks up any weapons. No matter how fierce a demon who comes, Krishna just effortlessly, like a child playing, he takes care of those demons. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that this demon Vatsasura represents wickedness. Wickedness is different from weakness. All of us have weaknesses. Weaknesses may be lust, anger, greed, envy, arrogance, illusion. We all have these weaknesses within us. Weaknesses means that we might get angry. When we get angry with someone, we yell at them. We speak harsh words at them. So this is anger. Now normally, all of us have some of these weaknesses. So the word weakness, what it means is that they make us weak. Or that there's a particular way, a strong, principled way in which you want to behave. But these weaknesses, they sabotage of us and they make us behave in unbecoming ways. Now, when does a weakness become a wickedness? Who is weak and who is wicked? I was in Central New Jersey last year. I was invited to a mental health care center to speak to the mental health care providers, because they have to offer mental health care to the patients, and because of that, over a period of time, they themselves get stressed. And when they are stressed, they need care. So one of them was telling me that they had a patient who came into their facility, and this patient had not been told that you're going to be admitted here. Been told just come for consultation. And when he came to know that he was going to be admitted, he got so angry that within 3 minutes, he actually destroyed $10,000 worth of equipment over there. They had armed sentries who came in and stopped him. But even before those people, the people could come, just went wild. So, normally, all of us have anger. But nobody can say that I'm completely free from anger. Although all of us have anger, there are different ways in which we may express our anger. When some people get angry, they just give others the silent treatment. Like small children, if they quarrel with each other and they say, I will not talk with you. Katti. So I will not talk with you. Sometimes adults may say, I'll just not talk with you. Silent treatment they may give to the other person. Or sometimes some people get angry, they may just talk in short grunts, not speak any pleasant, agreeable. Some people may go to the other extreme and they get angry and they just start yelling at others. It's like a dam is broken and all kinds of words are flowing from them. Some people, when they get angry, they may not just become verbally abusive, but they may become physically abusive. You know, where they start slapping, they start hitting, they start punching. Even physical abuse, Somebody may just be slapping and punching. Somebody may take some sharp, dangerous objects and start hitting. May take a knife, may take a bar. Some people, in cases of road rage, if somebody honks from them behind, and they get so angry, why are you honking at me? Let's take a gun and shoot the person there. There are deaths which happen because of road rage. Now, all of these are anger. But they are varying degrees of anger. So, we all have weaknesses. But when our weaknesses make us act in ways that hurt others, that is when they become extremely dangerous. And that is when people need mental health care. That is when some serious intervention is required. And if somebody does not try to rectify their weakness, as their weakness may be there, and weakness may express itself in different degrees. But on top of that, if somebody has weakness and they not only don't, and weakness is expressed in dangerous ways, but instead of battling to control it, they simply try to cover it up. As if it is nothing wrong. They try to cover it up. So our weaknesses need to be cured, not covered. So somebody covers them and then pretends as if I am a nice person. So in Western literature, there is this story of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. The same person in the daytime was a very compassionate doctor who would go out of his way to take care of patients. But at night, that person would become like a terrible criminal who would do horrible things. So what happens? Our weaknesses, if we try to cover them up and if we are not at all trying to deal with them, then we become two-faced like this. It said that some people are wise and some people are otherwise. And actually, it is not just some people are wise and some people are otherwise. Actually, we ourselves are sometimes wise and sometimes otherwise. So sometimes we speak and act so insensitively, so intelligently, so kindly, and sometimes it's like a different person has come within us. So, and suddenly starts behaving in very strange ways, scary ways at times. So what happens? When somebody has a weakness that is dangerous, and instead of dealing with it, they're simply covering it up and acting as if they're normal. So that's when it tends towards wickedness. Wickedness is just somebody who is harsh and cruel, that doesn't make them wicked. But if they are harsh and cruel and they don't feel anything wrong about it, and they don't do anything to correct it, then it becomes extremely dangerous. All of us have a voice inside us which tells us, don't do this, when we try to do some, when we are about to do something wrong. That is the voice of conscience. And this voice of conscience is actually like our inner protector. It's just like when we are about to put our hand in fire. When the hand is about to go in fire, at that time we feel a burning sensation, we feel pain. Now the pain is not pleasant, but the pain which is unpleasant protects us from something even more unpleasant. That is the whole hand getting burnt. So the unpleasantness of pain saves us from a greater unpleasantness of a scarred or a burnt hand. Similarly, when we do something, when we are about to do something wrong, or when we do something wrong, at that time we feel guilt within us. Hey, I should not have done like that. That was not right for me. So when this guilt is felt, it's not pleasant. Because for all of us, for any of us to admit that we are wrong, or we did wrong, it's quite difficult. So when this guilt comes, it's an unpleasant feeling. However, the conscience, which sometimes tells us we are doing wrong, It is like our inner protector. What pain does at a physical level, the sensation of guilt which comes from our conscience does at a subtler level, at a behavioral level. Hey, you should not have done like that. I should not have spoken like this. I should not have acted like that. This conscience, even if we do wrong, the conscience reminds us you did wrong, and then we do something to correct it. But this conscience is not a given. Not a given means its conscience doesn't always stay as it is. If we keep doing something wrong again and again and again, then the conscience dies out. It becomes muted. It becomes so silent that it almost becomes like dead. And there are people who are sociopaths, people who are psychopaths. They just heartlessly kill others. That for them the conscience is completely deadened. Their conscience is numbed and dumbed. They numb their consciousness, sometimes they numb their conscience, they dumb their consciousness, and then they dump their conscience after that. When the conscience is numbed and dumbed and dumped, at that time, the person becomes very dangerous. So our weaknesses are there within us, and yes, we can't get rid of those immediately. We may have lust, we may have anger, we may have greed. We can't get rid of them. But are we trying to deal with them? Or are we trying to simply cover them up? Cover them up means that when we feel I did something wrong, rather than admitting it, just say, no, nothing is wrong, everything is all right. So Vatsasura had a wicked intention. He was not just angry, he was not just cruel, he was wicked. Why? Actually, to kill someone itself is brutal. But to come to Vrindavan, where everybody is so worried about Krishna and everybody's heart is in Krishna, everybody is concerned about Krishna, and there to take on a form of the most innocent and harmless creature. Normally a cow, I mean, cow is also gentle, but sometimes the cow is big, and cow may seem to be a little dangerous, but a calf is so small and tender. But this demon took the form of the calf and came. So he was not just angry or violent, he was wicked. Wicked because he is covering up his anger and malevolence under a mask of gentleness, under a mask of kindness. So when this happens, when somebody is two-faced like this, somebody is wicked like this, that means they are having unholy, unwholesome desires within them, but they are not at all trying to restrain them. And if some voice tells them to restrain them, they restrain that voice. Instead of restraining the unwanted desire, they restrain the voice that tells them that this desire is unwanted. And that way they remove all inner restraints to them. And then they can do terrible things. So for all of us, we have weaknesses within us. But even if the weaknesses are there, we have to be careful that they don't get degenerated to the level of wickedness. Now, wickedness means that we don't feel anything wrong about what we are doing. Not only do we not feel anything wrong about it, we are actually doing things which hurt others. I say, that's okay. It's the way life is. So, having some weakness is not a problem. That we all have, but covering it up, denying it, and then acting as if everything is nice, when actually the weakness is hurting others, that is when it becomes a very serious problem. So when this happens, now Krishna, he had to actually kill Vatsasura. That wickedness was killed by Krishna. Similarly for us, there are certain anarthas which can be forgiven, and certain which need to be punished. Forgiveness is a very important spiritual virtue. If somebody has done something wrong, we should have the capacity to forgive. But at the same time, forgiveness is not the supreme virtue. Dharma is the supreme virtue. The same Krishna, who is such a loving God in Vrindavan, the same Krishna actually tells Arjuna
to fight a war against the Kauravas. Krishna doesn't say, oh, be forgiving and forgive the Kauravas, whatever wrongs they've done. Krishna gave them that chance also. Before the Kurukshetra war, he allowed them to come as, he came as Shantidut and personally petitioned for peace. Now, Duryodhana had done grievous wrongs. Somebody might say, oh, he had so much envy within him, that's why he did it. Okay, now envy can be a weakness. Sometimes we all feel envy towards someone. That somebody does better than what we are doing. Materially they may have a bigger house, a bigger car, a brighter child. Then us, we might feel some envy about them. Spiritually also, if somebody does better than us, we might feel envious of them. But envy is a weakness. But when that envy changes, whereby we start trying to hurt others, we try to pull them down, we try to destroy them, then that is where it becomes dangerous. Now, that's what Duryodhana had done. He had tried to poison Bhima when Duryodhana and both of them were just teenagers. Then he had hatched a whole conspiracy to try to burn them alive. Then he had defrauded them of their whole kingdom. Then he had tried to dishonor and disrobe Draupadi. And after that, he had sent the Pandavas to the forest for 13 years, including one humiliating year of incognito exile. And yet, after doing all this, when Krishna came to petition for peace, Duryodhana had not the slightest sense of remorse. Not the slightest sense. What did I do wrong? I didn't do anything wrong. In fact, he was going to such an extent, he said, after great introspection, if I look at myself, I don't see the slightest fault in whatever I have done. It's amazing. He said, I don't see any fault in what I have done. And not only that, he said, then he goes further and he says, all of us have our nature. And I have simply acted according to my nature. So if anyone is to be blamed, blame the creator who gave me my nature. Now, Krishna did not give us our nature. It is we who have got our nature by our past life's karma. With children when they are born, some children may be gentle and sweet, some children may be just angry. Some children when they cry, it appears like they are going to bring the whole house down. So, children are also different. Each child has his own nature, his or her own nature, which comes from the previous life. So, although it's our nature, now again, with our nature, see, we are bound to our nature, but we are not bound by our nature. Bound to our nature means that we cannot just, if somebody is a kshatriya, they will always act as a kshatriya. That's something, it's like, say somebody has to carry a heavy bag. That they have, they are bound to it. They can't give up that bag. But just because they are bound to that heavy bag, that doesn't mean that they can't do anything else. With that heavy bag also, they can go here, they can go there, they are not able to run fast. So our nature may limit us in some ways. But our nature doesn't determine everything that we do. We are bound to our nature. The nature is like a big heavy bag which we have to carry. But still with that bag also, we have certain control. So Duryodhana showed not the slightest remorse. And not only that, when Krishna petitioned for peace, on the most accommodating of terms, he said, just give 5 villages. And what was his response? Yes? Yes, I want to give enough land even to put the tip of a needle through. This is sometimes when we say no, there is a no to a request. And then there is no to a person. It's like, just we invite somebody for a program and they say that actually, you know, I have some other engagement, I have to go here, so I can't come for the program. That's a no to the request. But if we invite somebody for a program and they say, even if I die, my corpse will never come for your program. Now, that is not no to the request, that is a no to the person. It's like banging the door, not just in the face of the person, but right onto the face practically. So, Duryodhana's response is like this, totally insolent. So his conscience had practically died. So he was wicked and he had to be punished. So what can't be forgiven has to be given up. Or if someone, whoever can't be forgiven, that person has to be given. Right at his birth itself, Dhritarashtra had been told by Vidura, this son is the way, when he was born, at that time jackal started braying. At that time, hyena started howling. All nature started giving inauspicious symbols. So at that time, Dhritarashtra was told by Vidura, he says, give up this son. He'll be the cause of the destruction of your whole dynasty. And he said, how can I give up my son? The flesh of my flesh, the blood of my blood. So Vidura said, yes, you can entrust in someone, let them take care of him. You don't have to just abandon him. You will have 99 other sons. Just give up this son. But he couldn't do that at that time. And the result of that was that wickedness, which is already there, it grew and grew and grew until he did a horrendous, monstrous things. So for all of us, what Krishna teaches is that now calf, normally there is no sin in the Vedic tradition which is considered greater than the sin of killing a calf or a cow. It's a gohatya is considered to be monstrous. The Prabhupada would say that if at all somebody has to eat meat, they can eat meat, but please don't eat the meat of cows. He says, even if you want to eat the meat of cows, he says, just wait for some time, let them die a natural death, then you take them. Then you can eat it, if you can't give up that meat. But, so, killing a cow is considered to be horrendously sinful. It's like killing our mother. The cow gives milk, just like the mother gives milk. And yet, Krishna killed a calf. Why is that? Because Krishna doesn't see the externals alone. Just if our externals are very attractive, Krishna doesn't get deceived by that. So Krishna saw, although this Vatsa looked very innocent, but inside the heart was wicked. And Krishna dealt with that. Krishna punished Vatsasura, and he didn't just punish Vatsasura. When Krishna kills someone, that person becomes purified. That person becomes elevated, even liberated. So similarly for us, if there are weaknesses in our heart which may go towards wickedness. So the weaknesses, we have to make sure that we deal with them in such a way that they don't lead to wickedness. Now what does it mean, wickedness? I said two things. First is, because of our weakness, we are hurting others. And second is, we are justifying to ourselves, actually it's not bad, everything is alright. If something within us tells us it's bad, what you're doing is bad. No, it's alright. It's okay. So these, we hurt others and we shut up the voice which tells us that we are hurting others, we are doing wrong. That is where we go towards wickedness. And how do we deal with it? We deal with it by hearing regularly. When we hear regularly about Shastra, from Shastra, then our moral sense becomes strong. Hearing nourishes our conscience. Hey, this is right, this is wrong, this is not to be done, this is to be done. Now of course, we may say, but I have got this weakness and this is so strong and I am not able to give it up. That's okay. Even if you are not able to give it up, that doesn't mean we have to give in to it. They said that anger might be there, but anger can also be expressed within limits. Anger can go out of limits. So generally for us, sometimes we just can't avoid succumbing to our weaknesses. But there also, we can choose properly. Now we can actually, sometimes we may not succeed in Krishna consciousness. But even if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, we can fail in Krishna consciousness. Not fail out of Krishna consciousness. Did I explain this point in an earlier class? Yeah. So fail out of Krishna consciousness, just give up Krishna consciousness, stop practicing it. No. We just focus on doing what we can in our situation. Bhakti is so wonderful that we may be unqualified, but we are never disqualified.
We are all unqualified. We have so many contaminations in our hearts. What qualification do we have right now to sit in front of the deities, even to worship the deities, to chant the holy names? We are unqualified. But Krishna is so merciful that he never disqualifies us. Unqualified means we don't have the qualification to participate. But disqualified means we are not allowed to participate. That never happens. So we may have our weaknesses, and those weaknesses may seem so strong that they may seem to be dragging us towards wickedness also. But if we turn towards Krishna, instead of looking at the weakness and thinking how strong it is, we look up from the weakness towards Krishna. You know, greater than our biggest anartha, greater than our strongest anartha is the strength of Krishna. And no matter how strong our conditioning is, Krishna is stronger than that. And Krishna, I'll conclude with this point, Krishna has faith in our potential. We need to have faith in his potency. What does it mean? Krishna has faith in our potential. Say sometimes a young boy or young child wants to become an athlete. Say a young boy wants to become a cricketer. Now there's so many young people who have dreams, I'll become the next Sachin Tendulkar. But very few of them actually become like that. But while they are trying to play cricket, if there is some great coach, that person, hey, you have got great talent. Now if you see all great sports players or great people who become, all people who become spectacularly successful, there is someone in their life who had faith in them. Everybody goes through discouragements. But if some very celebrated coach has faith in the potential of a particular aspiring cricketer, then they feel, yes, I can do it. I'll work hard, I'll practice, I'll do it. So similarly for us, we may feel, I have so many weaknesses. But Krishna has faith in our potential. Krishna has faith in our potential. And therefore, we need to reciprocate with his faith. How do we know that Krishna has faith in our potential? That's why he is present in our hearts as the Paramatma. That's why he has brought us to his lotus feet. That's why he has given us an opportunity to practice bhakti. That's why he has been with us lifetime after lifetime, although we have turned away from him for so long. So Krishna has faith in our potential. Now, so in that sense, Krishna is a great coach and he has faith in us. But actually, Krishna is better than even the greatest coach. Why? Because even a great coach can't create talent. And a great coach can only fan the existing talent, train that talent so that it will come out. But for us, Krishna is so great that Krishna can start even the tiniest spark of spirituality within us and fan it to a shining flame. Krishna has the potency. The coach can't transform an untalented player into a talented player. Coach can transform a talented player into an excellent player. But Krishna is such a coach, he can transform even the most impure person into the purest person. Om apavitra apavitrova sarva avastam gatopiva yasmaret pundarikaksham bahyabhyantara shuchihi Shri Vishnu, Shri Vishnu, Shri Vishnu. This is the potency of Krishna. So, he has faith in our potential, let us have faith in his potency. So if we have faith in his potency and keep practicing bhakti, rather than worrying, oh, I have this weakness, when will it go away, when will it go away, rather than focusing on that, we focus on Krishna. Let me practice bhakti as well as I can. Let me chant the holy name, let me hear Krishna Katha, let me do my puja. And by doing this, we will find that our weaknesses will go down. And as our weaknesses will go down, the soul's natural strength will emerge. And thus we'll become purified and we'll become increasingly satisfied in Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about the pastime of Vatsasura and what we learn. So I talked elaborately about how the Vrajvasis took Krishna from Gokul to Vrindavan just to have a safer locality. And Krishna insisted, I want to go to the forest because he had already got a glimpse of the forest while travelling. And although Yashoda insisted, but Krishna sweetly persuaded her. And then All of Vrindavan is concerned for Krishna's protection. The cows made all of Vrindavan so soft, so that by banging on with their hooves. And Yashoda Mai and the Maharaj wanted to go out with Krishna. And the Vrajavasis would be longing, worrying how Krishna is and longing, when will he come back? And amidst such a Krishna-centered situation, Vatsasura came in the most innocent of forms, a calf, and tried to kill Krishna. But among all deceivers, Krishna is the greatest deceiver. And Krishna effortlessly caught Vatsasura, although Vatsasura deceived the other animals, other cows, but he could not deceive Krishna. And Krishna detected and delivered Vatsasura, destroyed and delivered Vatsasura. And then this Vatsasura represents wickedness, where one has evil desires, but one is acting on those evil desires rather than acting to restrain them. We all have weaknesses, but there are different degrees of expression of those weaknesses. Our anger becomes dangerous when our anger's expression starts hurting others. And the weakness becomes wickedness when it hurts others, as well as when we silence our conscience and act as if we don't have any problems. So the conscience is like our inner protector, just like pain is the protector from physical danger. And if we need to silence the voice which tells us to do wrong, not the voice which has told us you're doing wrong. So we need to silence the voice of the weakness, not to silence the voice of conscience. So what? In some situations people can't be forgiven. Though Krishna was very forgiving, but when Duryodhana showed no remorse and slammed the peace proposal in the face, then Krishna had to punish him. And for us, this might seem scary. What if I have weaknesses? What if they become wickedness? No, I talked about how even if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, we can fail in Krishna consciousness, not out of Krishna consciousness. That means that even if we have weakness, rather than worrying too much about it, we can look at Krishna. Krishna, I have this weakness, please help me overcome it. We are all unqualified, but we are never disqualified. So, despite all our weaknesses, Krishna has faith in our potential. Let us have faith in His potency. Thank you very much. Krishna Bhagavan ki, Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhaktivinoda ki, Gaur Premanande.
Salut.